Please welcome the nicest man in R&B, Craig David! You don't get that on a bloody Zoom call, do you?
I know. Those ice stands are different, right?
Yeah.
It's good to be here, though.
It's good to have you here. It's
really nice. The scent feels like right.
He smells so nice. He smells really nice.
No, brilliant.
Oh, my God.
Is that okay, we might go back to Zoom. So you're here for R&B Fridays live, which kicks off tomorrow, which is
yes,
very good. What have you got in store for people?
I've got a full live band. Which is, and it's been a long time coming, getting back out here. I mean, obviously, with everything that's gone on over the last couple of years, but to be here and seeing people coming together to enjoy the shows again, and the band is all super amped up. Do you know what I mean? Even with jet lag, you find it. As soon as you walk on stage, I'm in my mode, so.
Yeah. We have a lot of people come through this show, and everyone says how much they love Australia, and sometimes we believe them, sometimes we don't. I genuinely believe that you have a genuine, deep affection for this country.
I really do. It's like, when I first started off on my first album, Born to Do It, it was like the arenas and places that we were performing here when I came over, it felt like a home away from home. The embrace, the love, the empathy that everyone had for me. So, I mean, it hasn't changed. And it really does. As soon as I get off the plane, I'm just like, OK, I could be back in... Melbourne could be London, you know what I mean? Or Sydney could be Bournemouth, or could be like... you know what I'm saying?
Sydney could be Bournemouth.
Well, yeah, it's because there's a
Stay
beach.
Stay tuned, Sydney,
there's
don't
beach,
tune out.
And there's sand. And, yeah, we haven't got many hotspots back in the UK for sunny destinations.
But yeah, sure, I understand. Look, I'm sorry to do this, but the last time we spoke to you, you mentioned something. I didn't follow up on it, but I have to take the opportunity. You mentioned with your song, 7 Days, which, as we know, huge hit, very sexy song about very sexy times with apparently quite a lot of people. Anyway...
where did it get into lots of people?
Well, OK.
We're going to just one, because... I'm just saying.
I just thought there were a lot of days in the year. Anyway, it's not important.
I think comparatively it was a lot of people.
But you mentioned about that song that you were 17 and living at home with your parents when you wrote it. Yeah, where's that bit in the lyrics?
See, that's the thing. When you are 17, you don't put those things into the tune. I mean, literally, you got to remember, like, at that age, there's a 17 years old, right? There's a lot of testosterone going on at that point. Yeah. So when I look back, I was like, thankfully, my mum and my grandma who raised me, the reason why, like, even I say making love in the song, there were so many other words I could have used for that, right?
Right.
But it's even kind of leaning in to have respect, knowing that I had, like, some parents, some people around me that I needed to be careful with, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, right, OK. So if you were unsupervised, that song would have been off the chain.
Well, you know, I mean, it could well have gone that way. I mean, and I think that's the thing. It's like when you're raised, predominantly for me, like I said, with my mum and grandma, the respect I had throughout all of the songs, I'd like to think that I always lent that way as opposed to kind of... And I always felt it was more poetic to kind of... Yep. To lead you in as opposed to kind of being so vulgar with things, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Craig, your fabulous music aside, you've also written your memoir, What's Your Vibe? It's very raw. It's incredibly honest. And I'm wondering, was there a part in the book that you found particularly difficult to write?
I think all of it, to be honest, because you're so unfiltered. I mean, like, when I write a song, you've got a blanket of a melody to almost hide behind. You can go as deep as you want, but you've got a melody to kind of to carry it. But when you're speaking in a book, you have to be really articulate with the words and make sure that they land, especially when you're talking about mental health or depression or lack of boundaries or imposter syndrome. And I think all those kind of things that I wanted to land in this book that resonated with other people, more so even than a memoir, it was like, can it help people? Because there's someone else who could do a memoir or unlicensed version and know more about my career than I do. But if I can land some stories and life lessons that could help people along the way, and let's talk about mental health and depression, only from the spaces of actually experiencing it. Because I think otherwise you can't really talk on these things. Like you're kind of like passively kind of like giving, oh, say an affirmation and you'll be fine. Mm. I was like, no, I've experienced this and now I can talk on it and hopefully help people. So.
Slight change of pace. Mm. We've heard a rumour that you're a little bit psychic, clairvoyant, and we're very impressed. But apparently you kept it a secret. Why did you keep it a secret when that's the coolest thing any of us have ever heard?
Do you know what's funny? We all have that a sixth sense in us. I mean, it doesn't have to be as far as like Elvis is going to come flying in and be like, "Yo, let me tell you a few things about what's going on." It's just more that gut feeling and sort of honouring it. You know, like you walk into a room and you feel like something's off here and I need to leave, and then the head tells you, "But you only just arrived, just stay." And then some fight kicks off and you knew that you should have left. I'm just, I found I lean into it a lot sooner. So I follow my intuition, and I've got an album called that too, rather than kind of like letting my head kind of dictate. So yeah, so I kind of just felt like the word psychic could get very kind of heady, and I'm just like, no, we've all got that sentiment, right. You know what I mean?
One thing I wanted before we go, we spoke to you about your rapping at the Queen's Jubilee, which is just amazing. It blew everyone away over there, blew us away. Is there any chance?
Of the rap itself.
Do you remember the rap, or do you have to?
No, I can try and just off the bat. do you want to know?
Yeah, now. They want to hear the rap.
Our time to hit the road. Feels like I'm getting younger instead of getting old. Got kids saying that new boy so cold. Even man that didn't like me now be getting involved. Plats of gold, forgetting many I sold. Them times I was a boy, 16 years old. Them times who would have thought where it would go? Now I'm on a roll and that's been in our control. Everything became different when I followed my intuition. And every time that I didn't, ended in nothing but getting me down. But what a feeling to be enough from the beginning. You show me nothing but love, and that love is certainly touching me now. Having fun? Yeah, of course, stepping out of an Uber like I'm up in a Rolls Royce. Every scream is loud, feel like I'm losing your voice. So many rhythms, got to reload them twice. Flip the script, I can. No introduction, no hesitation. No little boy acting like a waste man. To be honest, all it requires. The mic in my hand, when I flip the script, I bang.
I was looking for a place to jump in, I just couldn't quite find a place to jump in.
I teed you up just to. I did an alley-oop for you, you just had to just.
Frank David's book is called What's Your Vibe? By the way, that's how you have to read it. You have to read it like that. It's available everywhere now, and you can catch him at Fridayz Live. Tickets are on sale right now. Craig, thanks so much for stopping by.